Good morning, everyone. My name is Sonia from technologycatalog.com, and I would like to welcome you to our new webinar about the tech positioning program. Before leaving you with Erik Nijgveld, which is the managing partner of technologycatalog.com, I would briefly introduce you who we are. In the company, what we want to do is make finding technology in the energy industry very easy and immediate, together with all the required support to deploy such technologies. Indeed, a current problem is that there is a very wide range of available solutions which can cause confusion about what are the best technology investment for your business. And also, it is a great opportunity to be introduced to new technologies without having to travel. So I would like to invite you to visit our website, technologycatalog.com, to find and compare new technologies that will so enhance your business. Just to give you a few information about this webinar, it's going to last around 15 minutes. 10 minutes is going to be the presentation about how to boost your technology in 3 steps. And the 5 final minutes are going to be reserved for your questions, which you can submit through the chat box on your right. I will now let the stage to Erik, who will lead this masterclass and will let you discover how to boost your technology in 3 steps.
Thank you very much, Sonia, for the introduction. And I think my slides are going to appear in not too long. And as the slides come up, let me give some further background. And so indeed, today is about the tech positioning program that we run. And it's building on the experience that we have with technology deployment over the years in support of tens of operators. So the start of the company was in 2018, and indeed technologycatalog.com is our main product, but in addition we also support suppliers and operators with getting technology deployment going. So tens of companies, you see some logos on the right hand side. And certainly technology deployment is challenging, and this slide lists some of the challenges we've been facing throughout the years. One thing that is often mentioned is the fact that, yeah, the industry that we're in is a bit conservative or risk averse. That may indeed well be true. But what's certainly also the case is that, yeah, end users are overwhelmed by choice and often simply don't have the time or the specific expertise to get technology deployment going. And there are many other challenges. But the good news is that technology deployment can be done. So this is the uptake curve that we realized over the years where we were running technology deployment in Shell. And in the last job that I had there, one of the things initiated at the time was a technology replication drive. And not necessarily only new technologies, also very much focusing on things that have been done in one part of the world and not in another, or in one business unit, for example, downstream and not yet in upstream, or the other way around, or things done outside of the company and not yet within the company. And over the years, we learned better and better what it takes to get technology deployment going, including all the change management aspects. And certainly one of the challenges that we faced at the time was, which customer to target. And yeah, eventually we had a portfolio of over 100 technologies. And yeah, if there are over 100 assets, you have a matrix of over 100 by over 100, lots of choice. So if you do that randomly, yeah, you're busy running around and not being so effective. But fourthly, you can pretty much say argue what your best chances of success are. And that's very much also what we now do in this tech positioning program. So very much realizing that the position on the matrix, impact versus doability, is different for different customers. And naturally, if you have limited time or limited resources, yeah, you pretty much want to focus on technologies that ideally sit on the top right-hand side, but at least on the far right-hand side, the doability as high as possible. But also, where this tech positioning program can help is to then define actions such that the position on the matrix changes. And these can be sometimes fairly straightforward actions, sometimes a bit more advanced. But every time we run such a program, indeed, it results in a couple of specific actions or recommendations that people can take to position their technologies for success. So the tech positioning program essentially consists of three steps. As a first step, we ask the supplier to do a self-assessment, and it's good to emphasize this supplier can be an external supplier. It can also be someone from an R&D department in a big company trying to approach the right internal customers. So the methodology applies in both cases. And we ask the supplier to assess against the seven themes that I'll briefly go through in a minute. And the next step is then a two-hour dialogue that we run around the seven themes of the stress test. And what we then do is, that's what you see on the left-hand side, the red part, the red spider, is that we assess the current status by giving a score of 0 to 5 on each theme. And then also estimate what the score can be after the actions have been taken. And once this is done, it can also be translated into a simple impact versus doability chart, whereby the impact score is the lowest of theme 1 and 2, and the doability is the lowest of themes 3 to 5. And indeed, the lowest score determines the position. It's very much the weakest link that determines how doable a technology is. And the matrix is particularly useful if you want to have a look at the portfolio of solutions as illustrated on the previous slides. And what we then do as part of this dialogue, a two-hour dialogue, is to go step by step through the seven themes. The first theme is all around the perceived business impact, and very much say, who is really the person to whom you're selling this technology? And this is a straightforward question, you may say. However, it's typically the theme that we spend most time on during a tech positioning program. Because although the question may sound easy, it's at the end very often not so simple. And very often, in our opinion, the main person to target in the custom company is often a different one from the one that the supplier targets. Just to give one example, recently supported a company that had a great drilling technology that could potentially reduce the drilling cost by a very significant percentage. The natural tendency would be to talk to the drilling community about this technology, and that is of course a key step to take. But certainly a party that should be at least as interested in the solution are, for example, development managers or development leads who often don't have a drilling background, but still need to be aware of solutions that can potentially reduce the cost of projects by a significant percentage. And it can be a difference between making the project fly or the end of the project. So we very much explore together as part of this dialogue to whom this needs to be solved, but also how significant the impact is for that person. And it can be nice to go as high as possible in the organization, but it also means that, yeah, the higher you go, the less time that people will have for your solution. But also the other way around, the lower in the organization you go, the people may have a bit more time, but at the same time, they may not have the authority to take decisions. The next theme is all around business impact dimensions. And yeah, the more dimensions you can address with your technology, yeah, the more champions you have. It's great that technology helps to reduce OPEX, but if it also helps production or helps the environment, helps to improve safety, etc., the more of these items you can address, the more champions you have for your technology. And just to give one example, this is a great technology to address biofouling issues. It's part of the platform, technologycatalog.com. This technology helps to increase reliability, low OPEX, but certainly also energy efficiency, and as a result, CO2 emission reduction. And yeah, many companies these days, or essentially every company, has someone responsible for CO2 reduction. And by highlighting that, you certainly have one extra champion, the person responsible for the CO2 emission reduction. And part of this dialogue that we then have around the themes 1 and 2 is also in a fair amount, how do we approach that end user? It may well be someone to whom you don't have direct access, but that's still an important party to approach. And if you don't have direct access to the person, yeah, think about who in your network does have a direct link with that person, and someone also, yeah, part of your network, someone you have a trustful relationship with. If you need to build a trustful relationship with every potential end user, yeah, you spend a lot of time doing that. And sometimes working through others, or very often working through others, can be at least as impactful. But also it's important to think about the movers and shakers around the end user. It's the same like in daily life. If anyone in the audience would tell me today that Barcelona is the place to go to this year, I may think, great. But if I then speak to a colleague later on today and he or she mentions exactly the same, and my wife happens to say the same again when I see her this evening, yeah, then I start to think, hey, multiple people have approached me with this and said this is great to go, great destination to go to. Perhaps I should consider it. And with technology, it's the same. It's very powerful if potential end user hears it from multiple angles. And it's a process you can manage. In the interest of time, I'll highlight a few more slides, and then I'll open the floor for questions. And the pack that we're going to share after this call will include various other themes as well. The theme 3, risk and reward balance. Very often, when a technology is stuck in the mud, it's a result of this specific theme, that the risk and rewards are unevenly balanced. I can illustrate it with this example. What you see on the left-hand side is a big scaffold structure around tanks, big pyramid. And a company here in the Netherlands, Magnetic, they came up with a great technology to use magnets instead of traditional scaffolding, sticking the scaffold effectively against the wall and reducing the scaffold volume significantly. And yeah, fantastic, reducing man hours. It's also more safe. People feel more safe to stand on such a scaffold, interestingly enough, because it's more stiff. But it's not so easy to deploy. And certainly the reason for that, certainly initially, is the fact that this specific technology has to go through one of the main contractors to go to the end user. And a maintenance contractor may not be so prepared to see scaffold volume being reduced by tens of percent as a result of an innovation. It may eat into their existing revenue streams. Hence, a very uneven reward balance. And this had to be fixed, and very much by, yeah, giving the contractor the incentives, the commercial incentives, to still introduce an innovation like this. And actually, that's something you see very often. And not just in the case something has to go through a middle party, but also that they're uneven, that there's an uneven distribution of risk and rewards, for example, in the end user company, such that people quietly or not so quietly put their heels in the sand. Let me highlight one more theme in this call. And that's number 5. We have references. It also links to the indirect influencing that we spoke about earlier. The power of expert and user reviews. One of the reasons why we have it as feature on technologycatalog.com is that, yeah, very often nothing helps you more as a supplier that others say how fantastic your product is. And on technologycatalog.com, we wouldn't allow any anonymous reviews. It's only by name. An independent expert or user is not going to say anything nice about the technology if they don't mean it. They would put their credibility on the line. But by having such a review, yeah, it gives you fantastic material to showcase this to potential customers to say, hey, it's not only us saying it. It's only also this independent expert on an independent platform saying it. So it helps. It particularly helps if that specific expert or user is from the same country or region. It's of course great when you're in the UK or in Norway that somewhere someone in on another continent says something is great, but it even helps more if you make it visible that others have used it within the same region, and those can be great opportunities to replicate also within your company. The outcome of the stress test is visualized around 7 themes, I said. So this is one of the outcomes. In addition, for each of the 7 themes, we list the specific actions that people can take. And that's summarized in a brief report using Excel templates and sent to the supplier of the technology. And the final step that we then take with that supplier is to also have a bit of a follow-up discussion around 6 months after the tech positioning program is done, whereby we review what the status is and explore further steps that can be taken. If this is something of interest to your company, when your supplier, you can add it to your the subscription package. Just go to technologycatalog.com and go and select the right menu option on the suppliers or under the button Add Your Technology at the top right hand side. We also apply this process for operators to help with the positioning of internal technologies. And please contact us if you would like to discuss further. That's all I want to share this morning or this afternoon, wherever you're sitting. Thanks. Thank you very much. And I would welcome any questions you may have.
Thank you, Eric, for this super nice presentation. Yes, if you have any questions, please submit them through the chat box on your right. We're going to wait a few minutes until the first one comes in.
As perhaps some questions come in, I can give some further background how this tech positioning program can also help. So we do organize webinars like this one also for suppliers, as many of you are aware of. By doing such a tech positioning program, it helps which specific companies to target. And we then specifically invite the right people from those companies to these webinars. And that way you can create the right audience for your webinars.
Okay, first question. How many of the tech positioning programs have you run so far?
So in total, this program has been run on well over 200 technologies, so many times. In most cases, one-to-one with suppliers, but also part of the technology deployment workshops that we run. One of the workshops that we run is titled Technology Deployment, How to Get It Done and Maximize Outcomes. And the Tech Positioning Program is an integral part of this this workshop. And such a workshop can range in duration from 4 hours to 2 full days, dependent on the specific needs of the audience.
From Alex, with COVID and low oil price, some customers have stopped all work from outside without HSSE critical activities. Have you seen ways to still get new technologies implemented in such situation?
Yes, absolutely. So it's clearly a challenging time we're in at the moment. But at the same time, technology deployment can still be done and technology can still add tremendous value. It is very much a matter, very important to pick the right technologies. So there's little appetite at the moment to work on technologies that still take a long time before the money is paid back. So it's important to pick the right ones, but also around the right themes. Just to give one example, a theme that essentially for every operator results in impact is around optimizing the movement of goods and staff. So for example, technologies that can help to color data in a different way, or technologies that look at alternative way of transports. For example, using drones, not just for inspection, but also for delivery of goods, initially small goods, and perhaps over time, also some bigger goods. The development goes developments go very rapidly, but also to see if some activities can be eliminated. And another area where that applies, for example, around optimization of turnarounds or maintenance activities, where very often scope can be taken out, reducing cost, but at the same time reducing need for people to be on site, or whereby activities, for example, work preparation, can be done remotely. So clearly a lot can still be done, but it is very important to pick the right ones, and that's also certainly where this tech positioning program can help.
Thank you. Then another question from Peter. Thanks, Eric. Which are the steps that are most difficult to get right?
Yeah, it depends a bit. Thanks for the question. It depends a bit per technology. So it's not to say that one of the seven themes is necessarily easier than the others. But I would say if I pick two themes where we typically spend most time on discussing this with the suppliers is certainly the theme one on the perceived business impact, and into that, who's really the person who has most interest in this. And the other item is the risk and reward balance. And that's something you very often see, that there are always some people that lose out when something new gets introduced. And that in itself doesn't matter, but if you don't realize it and if you don't address it, there are forces at work that pretty much stop a technology. But certainly, all seven themes are critical. That's why they're part of this program. So it's important at the end to get all themes right. And as stated at the start, the doability is determined by the lowest score of the doability themes and the impact by the lowest score of the two impact themes. So that's how it also is visualized on the matrix. So if you don't get one theme right, you effectively have hurdles for deployment.
Another question from Brahim this time. Theme three, are you a supplier of this type of scaffold?
Yeah, so as a company, technologycatalog.com, we're not the supplier of any of these technologies. The technologies that you see on the platform come from other companies, so they use this platform to promote it. So no, we're not the supplier. At the same time, if we support operators, we indeed help to make the match as good as possible from the perspective of the operator, So we would, for example, advise the 10 things that can help you. And those can be scaffolding technologies. Those can also be subservice technologies, very much dependent on the needs you need to address. But also, whenever we support operators, it's good to say that we not only listen to the needs, naturally we do, but at the same time, we also make suggestions for technologies that make impact for operators that have similar assets or projects that you have, and that could therefore also make impact to you. So we do it both ways, making sure that we also highlight things that help others.
Then we have a message from Peter says, thanks. I agree, risk and reward is often overlooked and support taken for granted. Let's see, is there any other question popping in?
If not, then if there any questions would come up following this presentation, I'm more than happy to answer those. I realize I covered the whole program fairly quickly. At the same time, if you would like to get further backgrounds, we just posted a blog about the tech positioning program. You can access it via our website or via our LinkedIn channel. And if you would like to discuss further, whether you're a supplier or an end user or consultant, happy to discuss further how this program can be of most value to you.
So, of course, thank you, Eric, and thank you everybody for being here this morning. We are gonna share the material used during the webinar very soon with you. And of course, as also Eric reminded, if you want to discover more, please head to our website, technologicata.com, or also have a look to our social media channels. I wish you all a nice day, and we'll be in touch super soon.